Okay, let's start. Hello, everybody. Dear friends and colleagues, it is my pleasure to open a new series of the online seminars, Quantum Gravity and All of That. These seminars are aimed to bring together people working on the topics related with quantum gravity. These topics are mentioned here, and they are quantum gravity and string, quantum gravity and black hole, information paradox, galography, etc. We would like to thank our program committee member who helped us to organize this interesting and I think very stimulating meeting. And I would like to mention that it is not by chance that we started this series here at Stekhov Mathematical Institute in Moscow. There is an old tradition to organize quantum gravity seminars in Moscow. Let me mention the quantum gravity seminar that were organized by Moisey Alexandrovich Markov, Viktor Berezin, and Valery Frolov. These were several seminars within this series, and they were every 3 years, starting from 1977. And also, I would like to mention the seminar on quantum gravity and cosmology dedicated to the centenary of Matvey Bronstein. I would like to mention that about 80 years ago, Matvey started to discuss the fundamental problems of quantum gravity that we supposed to discuss in this meeting. And in the end of my presentation, on my short presentations, I'm sorry. I would like once again to remind you the main problem in quantum gravity. Is quantum gravity a theory of quantum space-time? What we have to do with ultraviolet divergences? Also the problem about some of the four-dimensional topologies. Also, a problem which I discussed last couple of years very intensively is the problem of quantum black hole and information loss or information paradox and problems with quantum cosmology. Okay, now it is my pleasure to announce our speaker today, Professor Harold Toft. Please, Gerald, share your screen. I stop my screen, so. And in this time, maybe Alex will explain you our role, how we supposed to organize our discussion. Please, Alex.
Yeah, okay, thank you. I will just take about 1-2 minutes. So we are quite a lot of people. So the idea is that during the talk, if you have questions, you raise the hands. And as we agreed with Professor Toft, sometimes he will stop after some logical blocks. And if there are urgent questions during the talk, you just will be able to ask. And on top of this, after the talk, we do not plan any time limit for discussion. So it will be open discussion as much as we want to discuss to settle all the open questions, which may be as much as we can settle them. And again, until sometime, we will moderate the discussion by asking you to raise hands in Zoom. And after this, we will ask people to unmute and speak. During the talk, it would be very nice if you all can mute yourself so that there is no extra noise. I mean, apart from speaker, of course. And then it will be, I think, well organized. And I'm very much happy to pass the word to Professor Toft, who will speak about real physics.
Thank you very much for this nice introduction. Can you all hear me?
Yes.
Oh, yes, everything is okay.
Anyway, what I would like to present today is an approach to black holes, which at first, not only I, but many other people also thought it is wrong. There seems to be very crazy things happening in the picture I'm going to sketch. And it sounds like that there are fundamental mistakes made. And even I should mention, I had a discussion with Ed Witten, and he also said there's a minus sign problem that your approach has. I claim that this can be cured, but more importantly, what I get out of this is a unitary theory for black hole evolution, a scattering matrix for all in and all out particles, which is perfectly unitary. And I think that is what in the very end should matter. But to make it unitary, you have to accept the entire approach and not just throw away half of it, because then the remaining half will indeed show failures and problems. So let me explain that briefly. The idea is, of course, to treat a black hole just like an ordinary particle. So here you see a Feynman diagram, where in the past particles attract each other and they collapse and make a black hole. The black hole lives for a while and then it emits particles, Hawking particles, and at the very end it undergoes its final explosion. This entire process could be represented by a Feynman diagram, a strange kind of Feynman diagram, but you could imagine Feynman rules for this system and to make that those Feynman rules compatible with everything else we know about black holes. So that was the sort of standard approach. Now I'm going through the initial phase very quickly because I presume many people know all this and will be just familiar with it. But for others, I just need a brief explanation. A down-to-earth view of a black hole is that you have space in a horizontal direction here and time in a vertical direction. And then if you take the Schwarzschild expression for the metric of a black hole, you find that everything depends only on r, the distance from the origin, but not on time t. So we have a stationary situation, and that situation, as most of you should know, is a horizon, the dotted line here, which means that if something falls into a black hole, in these coordinates, the fall will be slowed down exponentially and the object will never ever go through the black hole. Same thing if you expect particles to come out of the black hole, which at first sight doesn't look obvious at all, but this was a famous discovery by Stephen Hawking. These outgoing particles also come out exponentially slowly in the far past. So in the far past, particles came out. In the far future, particles fall in. It's actually infinite past and infinite future I'm talking about, because time literally stands still on the horizon. Here you see the orientation of the light cones, however. The light cone switches direction here. So inside this region, inside the horizon, actually the singularity lies in your infinite future, not anywhere close to the observer here, but it lies in the future. And on the other hand, if you twist the light cone the other way, you can say there's a singularity in the past, but not in the present. In the present, the black hole is just fine, but the present really stops at the horizon. I'll explain more of that later, but all these things imply that, of course, whatever you're used to for a black hole will be replaced with something unfamiliar, and you'll have to get used to a way of thinking that is required to understand general relativity. Normally, one draws a Penrose diagram, as you see here. The Penrose diagram is a rearrangement of the time and the distance or coordinates in such a way that the light cones are all oriented back in its usual direction, which means this is a conformal transformation for the space and time coordinates. But the conformal transformation is drastically different inside the horizon. In fact, that doesn't seem to be a horizon at first sight, because this black hole had been formed by matter falling in. Before the matter fell in, there was no black hole. There was certainly no past singularity or anything. But there is a future singularity, even for black holes of the kind that have nothing to do with quantum mechanics or anything like that, but the things that observed at LIGO and observatories like this. But there's a big problem with this metric, and that is that it's not invariant on a time reversal. Whereas the equations we have in general relativity with the time reversal invariant. So why is this picture not time reversal invariant? That's one of the very important issues that I'm going to raise and I'm going to hang on to. But most importantly, it's not invariant at all on the time translations. If a distant observer makes a time translation, then that would be associated with a Lorentz translation at the point where the horizon gets formed. And this means that Lorentz transformations are being mixed with time translations. And the whole lot has as a consequence that this diagram is not at all invariant on the time translations. So what if you want to approach a black hole the way I like to do, which is first consider the stationary case. Stationary case is clear. A black hole has been formed a million years ago. Now it doesn't show any time dependence at all from the outside, but you can throw things in. And according to Hawking, things come out as well. So you can think of throwing as many particles in as you get out, and this will create a stationary situation. And by doing so, you can create the Hamiltonian eigenstates of a black hole. This is important because if you have your Penrose diagram like this, it's very difficult to imagine the energy eigenstates because time translation is a complicated transformation in the face of this diagram. As I'll explain later in more detail, I'll make a drastic step and I'm consider the stationary black hole diagram. But the stationary black hole diagram isn't at all like it was in the previous picture. It actually contains two regions that look like our universe, region one and region two. And then here is a region that you enter into if you pass the future event horizon. And here it's where you come from if you came from the past event horizon. For a stationary black hole, one can use this kind of terminology. But you'll probably agree with me that you need quite some justification to use this diagram because it contains this entire strange region, another black hole. It doesn't make any sense in ordinary situations. There are people who think that this thing represents a different black hole somewhere else in the universe, or maybe in another universe, and that this region here is a wormhole. It's fine if you believe these things. I don't believe that's correct. First of all, in the classical theory, which has no particle evaporation at all, there is no region two. So the presence of the region two is going to be linked to quantum mechanics in an important way, much more important than you might think now, as I will show in the talk. But all this means also it is dubious because you might have different opinions about quantum mechanics. And everybody with a different idea about what quantum mechanics really is will also have different ideas about this diagram of the black hole. But I'm going to disclose right now that I'm going to use this diagram for my description of a black hole. But let's begin with the beginning. If you have a black hole, this is just the region, the conformal region that you would get if you want the Penrose diagram of an eternal black hole. You just don't know what happens if you go beyond the horizon here, and you don't know what was before the past event horizon. But one thing you can say, ingoing particles go in here somewhere in the future event horizon, outgoing particles will emerge somewhere from here. Now, there is this famous paradox of the information near a black hole. And the information paradox has it that you don't understand at all where these particles that go into the black hole leave their information. And you don't know where these particles get their information from. Because particles come out. Originally, they came out just in one state, the Hartle-Hawking state. But as soon as you measure something, you measure which particles come out and which don't, and where are they, then you are splitting up the Hilbert space of the outgoing particles into very many different states. And then the question is, which of these do you actually expect when you do an experiment with black holes? So the information paradox would have a natural answer if you would think that the outgoing particles carry all the information that the ingoing particles send in. Now, if you look at this diagram, you immediately see what the problem is. If you assume the ingoing particles go in the infinite future, the outgoing particles come out from the infinite past, how can the infinite future organize these outgoing particles which are in the infinite past? You'll need causality backwards in time. And this has been always held as an idea against the notion that somehow the information paradox should be explained by saying the Hawking particles carry all the information that went in, and that's it. But this shows at least there is a problem with that view, because the ingoing particles take forever to get in, and outgoing particles must have been formed in the distant past. So, but then you can look a little bit more carefully at this picture and say, well, let's look at the very late outgoing particles. Maybe they have been affected by the very early ingoing ones. The idea being that the ingoing particles approach the horizon exponentially fast, so you don't have to wait very long, and the ingoing particles are at the horizon. That's exactly the spot where you expect the outgoing particles to come from. So they'll be very close to each other. Maybe they will affect each other. The ingoing particles will affect the outgoing particles. And this could be a way to transmit the information. Or you can say the very early ingoing particles, which went way long ago, so they're very close to the past event horizon, they meet the very late outgoing particles here. Maybe they interact. So the information paradox is not that bad at all. It is just a paradox about this very small rectangle here, parallelogram here. This very small region, that's where the information in should somehow be passed on to the information out. So this is what my theory will be about this very tiny region. And that region is very close to the Planck scale. So you might expect whatever the answer is to the information paradox, it's Planck scale physics that is going to be relevant for that, because you're never further away from this origin than about a few Planck lengths or so. So that puts a picture in a different light. What you really should say is that there are two regions of the black hole. This is the ordinary region, where all you have to do to understand what's going on in this white region is you introduce a Cauchy surface, you put particles on the Cauchy surface, and then you ask theoreticians who do quantum field theory on curved space-time to ask how do these things evolve. And they evolve some way or other in curved space-time. As long as you stay away from this horizon, everything is ordinary. The gravitons that you talk about are just very small, very light perturbative things. And the curvature of space and time itself just gives small corrections to a theory which we understand very well, which is quantum field theory. So let's assume that quantum field theory is true in this entire white region, but the pink region here, that's the dangerous part. Close to the origin of the Penrose diagram, you're just a few Planck lengths away, but that is where somehow the ingoing particles should pass on the information onto the outgoing particles. And this is the theory I've always had about black holes. As a particle physicist, I said it can't happen that the information just disappears like that. No, there are plenty of outgoing particles. They should carry all the information you want to know about. So what's wrong with that? Well, not only that's wrong, there is a mechanism which I'm going to explain to understand how the gravitational interaction between in and outgoing particles can provide exactly this transfer of information that you want to understand. And the reason is that the smaller the distance scale you're looking at, the stronger the gravitational force becomes, even the gravitational force between particles themselves. So if there's no any other interaction, there certainly is the gravitational interaction that ingoing particles have with the stream of outgoing particles that they meet right here. So certainly the gravitational force will be very important. Let us see what the gravitational force actually does. And to compute that is actually fortunately very simple. Let's just take two particles that go very fast and they meet each other at some point. How do they interact gravitationally? At first you would say they don't interact at all because gravity is so extremely weak, but then very close to the Planck scale, they'll interact. And the question is how? It's actually a straightforward calculation. You first take one particle to be stationary and have the other particle move around very fast. So the red particle is a fast moving particle. The green particle is a very slow moving particle. Then all you need to know is how does a fast moving particle affect the wave function of another particle which it meets halfway. That calculation is remarkably simple. You can do it by going to the Lorentz frame where the red particle stands still and the green particle is going very fast, or you have the green particle stand still and the red particle going very fast. Not very surprisingly, because nature's invariant on the Lorentz transformations, the answer will be the same. And the answer is that in the frame of the green particle, the ingoing particle, this red particle, will have such tremendous amount of energy that the gravitational force drags the outgoing particle along a little bit, or the other particle. This is the Shapiro effect. It's well known in gravity that there's a time delay if a particle comes very close by the sun. It's not just a time delay, it's a shift. The particle shifts in space-time like this. This shift can be calculated, and actually I won't bother you with the details of the calculation, but it's straightforward. And this is the amount of shift you get. The shift is actually a shift in the light cone direction in a minus direction. The momentum of this particle is also in the minus direction. So the shift delta U minus is proportional to P minus. And then the coefficient of proportionality is a log of the transverse separation. Why a log? Well, it comes out of the calculation, of course. But you can also say, I knew it should have been a log, because if this effect is linear at all, then the only linear effect that you might expect is the Green's function of waves on a transverse plane. It's really two-dimensional physics that you have to solve to get this function. And this function is a solution of the Laplace equation in two dimensions. Nobody should be surprised about this function. Also, nobody should be surprised that the proportionality constant here is Newton's constant. And that delta U minus only depends on P minus, that follows from Lorentz invariance. The most difficult part of the calculation is the -4. But okay, you can believe me that it happens to be -4. And it has been done long ago by several people, even before Eichelberg and Sechser. There was Mr. Bonner who basically did the same calculation. So this is old. Now you can repeat that on the black hole horizon and you get roughly the same answer. But now you first have to go to a frame where the region near the horizon is regular. Those are the Kruskal-Szekeres coordinates. But also in the Penrose diagram, the region in the immediate origin of the Penrose diagram is actually non-singular. That's the statement that horizons are not physically singular, but only a singularity of the coordinate frame. But what happens is very similar to what happens in flat space-time. If you have a past, if you add an ingoing particle with a very large amount of momentum, which means it is very close to the past horizon, then an outgoing particle will be dragged along and go out a little at its somewhat shifted position. And now you can see that this is a rather drastic effect. Certainly, if you come very close to the origin of the diagram, then you might say that if this red particle gets enough momentum, then the shift will be dragged along, the particle will be dragged along the horizon. So this blue particle will then not be able to emerge here anymore, but is dragged across the horizon. Whatever this means physically, it implies that there's important physics to be done here. We have to figure out how to incorporate this drag in a reasonable way when we deal with black hole information. For instance, this green particle here was closer to the horizon, which means it will take longer for that particle to come out of a black hole under normal circumstances. But if I send in a new particle, this green thing will be dragged along. Here comes the first thing that needs to be explained. When I continue, I ask how does a particle continue? Normally you would say it continues in this direction. I'm saying no, this shift here has an effect on the entire geodesic of the particle. So if the green particle comes out like that, it will look like having appeared from here. But this is region 2 of the Penrose diagram, in region two, time is reversed. So going forward in time means going like this. So here, the particle comes in forward time direction, it dragged along, it wants to continue in forward time direction, but that's the other way around, it goes back. So the green particle is not being missed, its information is not being dropped in some mysterious interior of the black hole. The information, however, is dropped into region two. And there, this particle comes out as happily as it went in. And here you have a pink particle, which may be a particle which was planning to come out anyway, and is being dragged along. If you look carefully, you see that now, in front of the horizon, the drag is inwards. But this heavy particle can only also be considered as a heavy particle from region two. But now the drag is outwards, away from the horizon. So the red line here, which was here, it was just an addition of an extra momentum going into the black hole. Here it's the removal of that dimension because the shift is in the opposite direction. So you see, there are some minus signs that you have to worry about if you want to apply this gravitational force to understand how what happens to information in quantum gravity. So this is the first thing you have to realize, but then you see that if you now want to understand where information is going, you better use the entire diagram for the eternal black hole. And I wanted to do it that anyway, because otherwise you get no continuity here. But now you see that this continuity, this spot here, where the future and the past event horizons meet, this spot can jitter around by heavy particles coming in, heavy particles coming out. So they move this spot all over the place, and there's not a very well-defined region, well-defined instant where the horizons meet. It depends on the in and outgoing particles. So this means that I'm not really allowed to cut off space and time at the horizon, because the horizon depends on how many particles you later plan to throw in or throw out. So there's every reason to analytically continue the metric to this entire diagram, but also to say that the particles I'm looking at are particles coming in the horizon here, but in the other region, there are ingoing particles on this part of the horizon. You have to take them into account, all of them. Later in my talk, you'll see that this is an essential ingredient of my package of the theory that you have to follow, that you shouldn't ignore region two, whether you like it or not. But most importantly, this is the diagram for the eternal black hole, for the stationary black hole. So being stationary, I want a diagram that remains the same as time for distant observer continues. And that means I want these two regions. So for now, this is not yet completely sufficient justification. So if you have your doubts, you're quite welcome to, because it's in fact a difficult notion to understand. I'm going to use Cauchy surfaces. This blue region is a Cauchy surface that is the most appropriate Cauchy surface for this Penrose diagram, saying that time runs to the future here, but time runs to the past here. So if I have a particle here, I just follow it to the past to see where it continues. And here I continue the particle to the future. So the Cauchy surface in a field theory in this space-time is such that it pivots around this point. In fact, this is a stationary point of the Cauchy surface. This is infinity in the ordinary space. This is infinity in this strange second space. I may already say now, I'm going to explain it later in more detail, that I'm going to consider this to be just the antipodes of this region. So I take a black hole, and I'm going to say this black hole only describes half, one hemisphere of the black hole. The other hemisphere is this region. But now these two hemispheres of the black hole are connected through what used to be a wormhole. So I had this Cauchy surface. If another Cauchy surface goes on, then later it looks like this, and then later it goes like that. Particles can be anywhere on that Cauchy surface. But if I would interrupt the Cauchy surface at the origin, then the difficulty is that particles I drag along across that horizon, and then the information would get lost. So the only way to make sure that information is preserved is to take this entire diagram and have regions one and regions two equally participate in the dynamics of the whole thing. Now, what I'm going to, what I already mentioned, is the antipolar identification. It means that I'm going to identify this region of the metric to that region. By the way, this is a equal time slice of the same diagram I had before, but now at the fixed time, you see that, now you see at fixed time, you see your horizon here, but you see that these circles are actually S2 spheres, and the region where they're S2 spheres is I removed one dimension to make this picture clearer. So it's actually space itself is two-dimensional, but this is now a sphere, and the sphere is the smallest sphere of the black hole where r equals 2m. So this small circle is the sphere r equals 2m, but the region 1 and region 2 r never goes to 0, not at finite times. That gives me a possibility to interpret this other region as the other hemisphere of the same black hole by saying, I'm going to cut it out, and I'm going to say that if you are in this region of the black hole and you go to the
hello, Androl.
Sorry. If you go to this region, then
hello, Androl.
Sorry, some questions, please.
Is there a question?
Any questions?
So what I'm going to assume is that this region of space-time is not present, but it has to be replaced by the same region, but at the other side. I'm going to go to the theta and phi of the
hello, Androl.
And maybe you can mute that person.
No.
Oh. Or is there?
Could you please mute everybody? Unmute
everybody. I'll stop soon enough for questions. Just one moment. Then, so what happens is if that the geogrammatically, this space time behaves in such a way that if you move in, you might think that you are continuing, but actually you flip over to the antipole at this point, and you continue your journey back into in region one again. The advantage of this is that now the external universe is again a single universe, not two universes. And now you can say that all particles I'm ever talking about are particles that live in this single universe. And now you can try to understand how the evolution of all states is and how you can recover pure quantum mechanics from this picture. So the claim is also that there's no cusp singularity. I had Penrose himself in my audience the other a few weeks ago, and he was complaining that this should give a cusp singularity. But that would only be a cusp singularity if there would be a point where r equals zero. But at all finite times, r never becomes smaller than 2gm. And that means that there's never a cusp singularity when you equate this particle with the particle at the other side. But the only transformation that does this is the antipolar transformation, where x goes to minus x. So for me, it's very important to have antipolar x go to minus x. If you did, not do that, then you would say that if you go through here, you come back in the same space at the same angles theta and phi, but then that you generate a singularity at this point. And I don't like physics with singularities if I can avoid them. So this is the basic argument. So there are no cusp singularities, and it's the only non-trivial mapping of the Schwarzschild metric onto itself that does not generate a point where you have a cusp singularity, but that is, this will be the way to recover bijectivity of the mapping. You know, in the diagram you just saw, a single point in the universe is represented by two points in the diagram. That's a 1-to-2 mapping. You can't do quantum mechanics if you allow 1-to-2 mappings on your coordinate frame. So, but this mapping now has recovered bijectivity, so that every single point on this space-time now maps onto a single point in the universe. That's the kind of mapping I want to use to do quantum mechanics.
Is your mapping antipodal in both time and space directions in the Penrose diagram?
Sorry?
In the Penrose diagram, you make an antipodal mapping on both R and T or only on R?
The mapping, well, time goes to minus time.
Yes.
But the space goes to minus space. Actually, I'll argue it's going to be a CPT mapping. So X goes to minus X, T goes to minus T, and charge goes to conjugate charge.
To answer my question better, is it a pi rotation of the Penrose diagram or a reflection of the Penrose diagram?
It's a transformation in four dimensions.
I know that. But if we just look at it in the Penrose diagram, where we only show two dimensions, I know that on the other two dimensions that aren't in the Penrose diagram, you take the antipodal map.
Yes.
But in the two diagrams you do show, I can imagine two things you could mean. You could simply exchange left and right in this picture, or you could make a pi rotation of the picture around the origin.
Around there's only one antipodal mapping you can do. And
so antipodal is in the full four-dimensional sense.
It will come out to be in the four-dimensional sense, yes.
Okay, thank you.
So, but there's going to be many questions of this sort, by the way. It's very important, these things. And there will be points where you will criticize me, but I'll go back. But first, let me explain to you that if you do this, then the gravitational force between in and outgoing particles will be the force that will restore unitarity for the evolution operator. So it's a very important thing to consider, at least. But let me first show to you how the gravitational shifts work in this case and how you can use it. So also on the horizon, you can have local light cone coordinates, and the shift in these three coordinates are just like the expression I had before, except this F is no longer a pure logarithm, it's a Green's function on the S2 sphere. And then, so on the S2 sphere, I have that U minus is the coordinate of the outgoing particles, that coordinate is being shifted. And this is the Green's function. It turns out on the sphere, it obeys the one minus Laplacian of theta and phi. The one is due to the curvature of the sphere. And so this is nearly a logarithm, but not quite. At small distances, it's a logarithm. But otherwise, it's just a finite function, which unlike the logarithm, it has an absolute meaning because of the one. So if I'm now considering an addition of momentum P at a certain point, omega one or omega I. At the point omega I, I'm going to add a particle with momentum PI in a minus direction. So there are N punctures, so to speak, on the horizon where a particle enters. And then the outgoing particles will all be shifted. And because this equation is linear, and that's a very fortunate thing, everything is computable. And the outgoing coordinates of the outgoing particles are all shifted by this expression, where you just have to take the contribution of all these ingoing particles one by one. But you can also say this could be a more generic distribution. And then this is just the solution of the Laplace equation, where this is a source of the ingoing particles. Now I'm going to make a very important step. And that step will look very strange at first sight, if you're not very careful. And that is, I said I made a shift. I added a particle going in, and that addition caused a shift. Now I'm going to replace this equation by saying I consider all ingoing particles, PI, and I consider the average location of all outgoing particles. So I remove the delta. If you think a little bit, it's quite natural to remove the delta. You could say that the early ingoing particles cause tremendous big shifts. So the origin of coordinate spaces is ill-defined anyway. Let's choose a new origin and then say, compared to that origin, I have extra ingoing particles or extra outgoing particles. And this shift, the extra shift is equal to the shift itself. So I leave out the deltas. And now this says that if I know the wave function of my ingoing particles, I will know the wave functions of the outgoing particles. All you have to do is Fourier transform. And indeed, you have the momentum of the incoming particles, which is being replaced by the position of the outgoing particles. And of course, when you talk about momentum and position, you're going to talk about quantum mechanics sooner or later. We're going to have to use the fact that in quantum mechanics, these two happen to still commute. But if I do the same thing for the outgoing, where in and out are interchanged, then I have a problem with commutation. And that makes the whole situation quite interesting for quantum mechanics. And my claim is that this will also remove the firewalls, but that is already running ahead of my story. But let me first do something else to make the calculation a lot easier, which is, let's, instead of taking particles, I take a spherical wave expansion. I take a partial wave expansion, just like you do with the hydrogen atom. I can imagine when Schrödinger first looked at the hydrogen atom, he must have had a difficult time until he realized I can expand everything in spherical harmonics. And then it becomes easy. Well, let's take all these incoming particles, whatever momentum distribution they produce, let's expand that in spherical waves, in partial waves. And then this Green's function I talked about is diagonal in that space. So that means that at any given L and M of the partial wave, the shift of the incoming particles is just proportional to P minus. And this is now a constant. If you choose some L, it's just one over L squared plus one, because of the plus one I had before. And the Newton's constant appears again. And there's something very remarkable about these equations, which is that for every L and M, there's only one partial wave to talk about. So I'm going to talk not about wave functions of incoming particles, I'm talking about momentum distribution of the incoming particles. That momentum distribution is basically an operator, but it has only one particular value for every L and every M. It is a function of state and phi, of course, but once you have all the incoming particles at different states and phis, you're left over with a pure distribution. A situation which is very similar to what we have in string theory. In string theory, you also think of incoming and outgoing particles in terms of vertex insertions. So if you look at the previous picture, these were vertex insertions on, well, what isn't the string world sheet now? Now it's the horizon of a black hole. But otherwise, these equations look exactly like in string theory. And here also, when you go back to L and M, you say, well, I really want to have the string distributions in partial wave. That's much easier to do my calculations. Now these become linear calculations, but also there's only one U and one P for every L and M. Well, I should say there's one U plus, one U minus, one P plus, and one P minus. U minus is proportional to P minus. But now, by Fourier transforming this, you say, okay, the Fourier transform of U minus is P plus. The Fourier transform of P minus is minus U plus. So if I interchange U and P, I get the same thing with a minus sign. So now you see that you now get complete sets of equations. And now you can notice that the commutator in momentum in the spherical wave notation, the commutator is diagonal. It's just delta L prime, delta M prime. And that makes life a lot easier. In fact, this becomes one-dimensional quantum mechanics. For every L and M, there's just one U, one P. It couldn't be easier. You can start solving the equations and just see what happens. And but before solving the equations, you have to realize the relation between these local light cone coordinates near the horizon and the distant coordinates that the distant user likes to use. For the distant user, the relation between his coordinates and the coordinates of the local observer at the horizon is exponential. So the U plus or minus behave exponentially as a function of the time for the distant observer. This is a tau, the Greek time. So you have this exponent in the relationships between things close to the horizon and things far away. So that means that we can introduce tortoise coordinates, but then we would like to use momentum for the outside observer, for the distant observer, and momentum and coordinates for the distant observer. And their relation between the local light cone coordinates contain these exponents. So And you can see that immediately by looking at the energy eigenstates. The energy eigenstates for the distant observer are just exponential in tau, but that means that for a local observer, it means that u plus u minus increase and decrease exponentially, and so do p plus and p minus exponentially for the distant observer's time. Now, I mentioned already before, I wanted to understand what happens with energy eigenstates. So let's take the ingoing particles to be in their energy eigenstate, and let's have the outgoing particles in their energy eigenstates as well. Then I'm describing a stationary black hole. Let's see what you have then. Well, to do that, you have to take out this exponential and say that u plus is e to the power rho. I can't give it a new name, rho for the ingoing particles. It is rho out for the outgoing particles. So the relation between the distant observers of coordinate and the local observers coordinates is exponential. Nothing wrong with that. I can just take these equations here, put in those exponentials and see what I get. However, exponentials can never be negative. And I know that I will only get decent equations if I could do this over the entire Cauchy surface. Now here comes another very important reason to take the full Penrose diagram, because the Cauchy surface is run from minus infinity on one region, in region one, to plus infinity in region two. And so because of that, the Cauchy surfaces have u pluses that are positive and negative, and the same for momentum. Momentum can be positive and negative. So if I want to do this coordinate transformation here, I have to take out the signs and treat them explicitly. So the ingoing sign is plus or minus, the outgoing sign is plus or minus. These two signs for a wave function do not commute, so I only need one sigma, but I can't do it without this sigma. Basically, sigma tells me whether I'm in region one or region two of the Penrose diagram. And you find that indeed the equations become invariant on the time shifts for the distant observer, because if the distant observer goes to another time variable, then you see that the local observer increases the u pluses and decreases the u minuses, or the other way around with the p's, in such a way that this transformation here is an invariance for the local observer. That's the statement that the local observer makes a Lorentz transformation if a distant observer makes a time translation. So now you see it's easy to use time translation invariance in these equations. You just say use the u's increase, the p's decrease. But what that happens if you do that for the Fourier transforms? So this was, again, the diagram. Well, I now take my ingoing wave functions as plane waves for the distant observer. So that means that they are exponentially increasing waves for the local observer. So the Fourier transform of that for the local observer will not be the Fourier transform for the distant observer. And that means that the things I call P are not momentum for the distant observer, because Fourier transformation is really something very different. You have to ask, what is the Fourier kernel if I use exponential coordinates? This is not a hard calculation at all. You can do that, and you get out, as an outcome, you get typically Euler functions. You get that if the X and the P, I just have this Fourier kernel, then if I look at the distant coordinates X and the distant momentum coordinates P, then for distant observers, again, the X and the P commute as usual. But now you have this exponential dependence. That means that the Fourier kernel for the distant observer is a more complicated looking expression like this. I didn't put in all the details of a finite size black holes. I just basically took an infinite size black hole and treated the black hole as a Rindler space. That saves me a lot of technicalities, and it makes this calculation very straightforward. So now you have to take this as a Fourier kernel and just see what happens. That Fourier kernel is very convergent in one direction because of this exponent, but it becomes the exponent of an oscillating function or of an exponentially behaving function. So the Fourier kernel becomes very regular in one direction, but very singular in the other direction. You might say, aha, this is bad. But you can also say, let's take as my test functions, sufficiently smooth functions, so that these rapid oscillations die out. That's what you normally do in ordinary Fourier transforms. You can do the same thing here and find out that indeed everything stays finite, provided you take sufficiently smooth test functions in this point. And then the outcome is that you get a new kernel function. This is the kernel. And now you can Fourier transform that by saying, well, I looked at this equal at this constant time eigenvalue. So now this is my test function. Certainly, it's very smooth, and so it will rapidly. So this divergent Fourier kernel will rapidly disappear in both directions. So it's an integral you can easily do. And in fact, these are the Euler integrals. So what you get out of this is that the wave function for distant observers, which depends on the distance from the black hole, but also it depends on the sine coordinates, whether you are in region one or region two. And so the ingoing particles can be written as this way, which is a time translation invariant covariant function for the distant observer. Then the out wave function can just be calculated. I have all the ingredients in my equations now to calculate how the particle comes out. And this is the answer. That is to say, this is the Fourier transformation, not yet the complete answer. This is the Fourier transformation. The Fourier transformation contains the Euler gamma function. The one half comes about from a normalization of proper normalization of these wave functions. The I kappa, that's kappa is the energy eigenvalue of the ingoing and outgoing waves. Energy is conserved. So the outgoing wave will have the same energy as the ingoing wave. And the evolution operator now becomes a 2x2 matrix. That is the signs can be plus or negative. And you find that the plus and negative wave functions, they cross each other. So particles go from region one to region two and back. This equation is unitary. The reason is very simple. The Fourier transform is a unitary function. Therefore, this must be unitary. I didn't need to calculate anything. This must be a unitary matrix. But you have the properties of the Euler gamma functions, which are only too familiar to most of us. These properties of the gamma functions that ensure you that indeed you find exactly that this matrix with this prefactor becomes an ordinary unitary matrix. So I've shown unitarity to come out. So now let's put the scale factor back in. And then with this scale factor, which is just this factor L squared plus L plus one, which came from this Green's function on the horizon, then you get this as an S matrix. These Fs are just the Fourier transform kernels, but now in the energy eigenstates. And you see it's completely finite, it is also unitary. But then, and of course, what you use here is the elementary equations that relate the Euler gamma functions to this kind of integrals, which are the integrals that you need. And there's a little remark here. L must be odd. That's because the all functions I talk about switch sign if I go to the antipodes. So to take hold of that, unfortunately, I can't use even L. But to be more precise, there is no even L if I use this antipolar identification. Only the odd L values contribute. That's because the ingoing particle, remember that the momentum of the ingoing particle went into minus momentum and it goes out when it goes in the other region. But that means that that only odd functions of the of L can contribute to all these equations. So L must be odd, otherwise I get into contradictions. And that actually is a good thing because I was overcounting my states, but keeping L odd, I reduce the number of outside states again by a factor two. So all is in order, but there's a twist in the meaning of angular momentum just because things are somewhat strangely connected at the origin. This, by the way, shows that it's a non-trivial thing I'm doing. I'm only keeping even angular momenta, but at every angular momentum, I have two functions now. So with the antipolar identification, I again get one asymptotic region. Otherwise, I couldn't do physics. That was really the argument. I don't believe in the argument that this has anything to do with quantum entanglement or something. I don't think it works to have one black hole to communicate with a distant black hole somewhere else, it doesn't work. If you take, by the way, if you take region two to describe another black hole, then you'll then this estimate that I just derived gives you a direct interaction between two black holes, a direct interaction which doesn't allow, which is not allowed by quantum mechanics, not even if these represent entangled states. They should not directly entangle. Remember, the Einstein photons in the EPR experiment, the Einstein photons are not mutually interacting as soon as they left each other. So that's certainly not allowed. So I don't agree with the people who think that. The horizon now is a two-dimensional projective sphere because the antipodes on the horizon were identified. But away from the horizon, there's no such identification anymore. It just means that my space and time is again completely regular, far away from the horizons, as it usually was. What I get is something that makes a black hole look like a gravitational instanton. That is that, if I go to back to the diagram for a moment, in the diagram, time runs forward here and backwards here. So this backwards running time must be, that's the reason why I said that the antipodes go backwards in time. That's really the reason for that, it's a time shift. The Fourier, the Cauchy surfaces must look the same in whenever I perform this transformation. So the transformation must be a regular SO or O3 rotation actually here. But so here you, you just perform basically, I think I may have answered Ed's question wrongly, but it depends on how you look at time here and time here, but the time for the local observer here is following the time to the future in this direction and to the future in that direction. So this is what I tried to say when I said that time is also inverted. Space is inverted, but the equations are such that you need CPT invariants to make everything work properly. So now I have this picture, and that says that that I have a projective sphere. Projective spheres means a sphere where the antipolar points are identified. It only happens at this point. But now you can think of extending space and time back again into four dimensions, far away from the horizon. You say, well, what the black hole really does, it removes a region of space and time. I just excise this region of space time altogether. It's not a vacuum, it's nothing. There is no space time. If you enter in this region, you just continue your journey at the antipolar point and you continue. This actually could be a good boundary condition for a gravitational instanton, except it's difficult to find equations for which this is totally finite, because unlike gauge theories, gravity is not scale invariant. So what you can do is try to make a conformal theory of out of gravity. And then you can say going from here to here is a conformal transformation. If you go from x to 1 over x, then that's a conformal transformation. And then you can say, okay, this leaves one point where r squared equals 1 as an invariant point. And you can say that in ordering space-time, you can say there's a region here. Now I'm going to remove this region and say that I'm going to connect on this horizon, these crosses with those crosses, these circles with those circles, and so on. So I call this thing a vacuole because it's not really vacuum in the usual sense. It's completely empty also of space-time itself. I had some graduate students who looked at this, but they started work on gravitational instanton, but it wasn't quite the right one. It still developed some awkward situations. So, but if you add matter to the theory, it's very likely that you can make a gravitational instanton this way. You do need matter to make black holes. So it's not very surprising that if you have no matter around at all, it's hard to get such an instanton larger than at Planckian scale where nobody knows what happens. But if you add matter, then you can get, of course, real black holes. And then this is the Euclidean extrapolation of a real black hole where instead of Minkowski spacetime, we have locally Euclidean spacetime. And then the gravitational instanton becomes a pure sphere. This is not trivial, For instance, you could ask what happens to the baryons. Baryons go into antibaryons at the other side. So baryons are not, baryon number cannot be conserved in such pictures. But PCT can be kept correct in this picture. I like to think that, well, this is really a topologically non-trivial spacetime. And the proof of that is that in this spacetime, I can draw a Möbius strip. And what I can do is I can take a closed curve where this closed curve goes through the horizon of a black hole to the antipodes. And I go far away from the black hole and I close the curve just like that. And but here I have to invert the notion of time. And then I continue. And now you see that to continue back from the antipodes to the region itself, you have to rotate time again. So you see that in the time, this is a very strange Möbius strip, which inverts time as the one dimension, which is turned around if you go around this strip. So it's really non-trivial. In ordinary space-time, we don't have such Möbius strips. So dx goes to dx, but dt also goes to minus dt at this spot. So it's really a TCP inversion that would allow such a Möbius strip. As you know, nature is invariant on the TCP, but not on the other combinations of P, C, and T. None of them is completely an invariance of the laws of physics as we know them, certainly not in the standard model. So, but this one Möbius strip is the one that you can use. So I was forced to demand that C is also inverted, otherwise, my laws of nature are not invariant. So then you might have a cusp singularity in the laws of nature of the kind that you don't like to have. Now, there are many things you can argue. One interesting observation is that the microstates of the black hole that you arrive at this way are discrete. And the reason for that is relatively simple. Put the black hole in a large container or a box and assume that those coordinates of particles u plus and u minus all vanish on the edge of the box. You can take the box as large as you want, and then you can now start to count states. Well, if u plus and u minus both vanish at the box, then also momentum p, because it's proportional to u, also vanish on the box. And so now we have the u and the p vanish on the box and have some regional space-time inside. Well, if you're familiar at all with the laws of quantum mechanics, you'll quickly realize that only leaves a finite number of states, because you cannot have both momentum and position compactified. Only for a very few discrete number of states you can have that. That means that there is a number of particles. The number of particles in every L mode would then be proportional to L capital L plus 1 times a constant. This constant is difficult to estimate because I'm not really putting the thing in a box. I'm putting the spherical waves in a box, but the spherical waves are both negative and positive. So it's a bit hard to measure what it means to have this thing in a box. But qualitatively, it's quite clear that if you take the box at a finite size, and sooner or later you get clashes with the equations unless you have only a finite number of states for every L. A problem which I have not yet been able to solve completely is this seems to diverge if you count all L states together. In fact, you have to multiply these n's for every L and M, because every L and M has a number of free states, but the total number of states you get this way are the states that you have in all L's and all M's together. So you have to multiply these to get a total number of states. That looks a little bit like Hawking, the Hawking temperature and the Hawking entropy, but not quite, because if you multiply these things, first of all, you have to do that in the logarithm. So you have to take the log of N, and then you find that the log of N is proportional to L. That means there's a divergence in the log of L of M for large L, which means I still have a problem with a finite number of states. There should be a natural solution to this. I'm convinced that if you look more carefully, you'll find that the only correct value for the total entropy in this theory should also be Hawking's value. So you expect an area law for the momentum for the states this way. I can say much more about the role of your I can say a lot more, but I think I really didn't find a good spot to stop for questions. If you have questions, I would propose to consider them now, and we have still quite some time for discussions, and I can try to fill in all the voids that are left. Thank you.
Okay, there is one question, yes.
Hello?
Please ask questions, yes.
Yes.
Yeah, hi. I mean, this is all very interesting, but if you have a collapsing object, you don't have a region two to make the identification. So how would this all work for that?
Okay, this is the usual question. As I said, I wanted to understand the stationary states of a black hole. So I wanted energy to be conserved. Now, actually, there are several answers to your question. One is that, I should say one at a time. First of all, you have the Penrose diagram of a stationary black hole. If you would assume invariance on the time translation, you should also have invariance on the time inversion. And for those energy eigenstates. And that means that the derivation for that the future, the outgoing particles are in a Hawking state, is the same state, same calculation, as saying that the ingoing particles must be put in a Hartle Hawking state as well. So what I'm really doing here is I'm considering ingoing states as really being Hartle Hawking states as much as outgoing states. If you do exactly that, you have zero extra particles in the universe. So the Hartle Hawking state in gives Hartle Hawking states out. That's not the contradiction of what you said, because there is no black hole formation at all. Black hole formation is in the infinite past. Now, then I say we can add more and more particles as seen by the local observer. Then you generate many, many other in states. And immediately you also generate many, many other out states. So the in and out states now are going to be related by the scattering matrix, which I mentioned. But I went, of course, much too fast in my talk. I should have explained that the firewall argument, and that is that if I have a very fast ingoing particle, then this tells me that the information the ingoing particle carries is also carried away by the outgoing particle. For every LM value, there's one ingoing quantum wave, one outgoing quantum wave. They are related by this Fourier transformation. So they carry the outgoing particle carries the information of the ingoing particle back out. I don't need another copy of that particle. The other copy would go through the horizon and cause havoc in region three or region four. But for physics, I only need regions one and region two. So I don't have that problem. If I want to ensure that I do my quantum counting correctly, I should not count the particles which enter into region three or region four. So it means that I'm not overcounting, neither am I undercounting, if I say that all the ingoing particles by Fourier transformation turn into outgoing particles. However, it means that I should not include the particles which actually went in very, very long ago. Because when they went in very long ago, their momentum has exponentially increased enormously. If I wait for a few seconds for an ordinary black hole, like a solar mass black hole, wait for a few seconds, you get e to the power 100,000 or so as a Lorentz factor. So the momentum of the ingoing particles is e to the power 100,000. That means the position of that outgoing particle also has a position e to the power 100,000 in the local coordinates, but that just means very, very far away. It went out 1 second ago. That's a long time ago for that black hole. So I should not include that particle. So the outgoing particles which I'm going to ignore are the outgoing particles which left long ago, which are elsewhere in the new universe. I'm no longer interested in them. So they are no longer of any importance. If I ignore those outgoing particles, that is tantamount to say I'm also ignoring those ingoing particles. In other words, the correct procedure to use in this framework is to ignore all particles that went in earlier than a few seconds ago. that certainly includes all the particles that went in during the collapse, which is long, much, much longer ago. So I should not use that Penrose diagram that describes the collapse. No, I should use the eternal diagram. That goes at the price. The price is the antipolar identification. Because now the horizons are not carrying this infinite sequence of very heavy energetic particles which made the black hole, nor does it carry the particles which come out very much later in time as Hawking particles. Both these generate firewalls on the horizons. In fact, on both horizons, the past horizon and the future horizon would carry a big firewall. I can't cross those horizons at all, neither in the future nor in the past. So if you want energy eigenstates, you do have to do something else. That something else is, you have to say those horizons connect in some other way. That other way is the antipolar identification. And then everything becomes unitary again. I could try to use other theories. I've tried lots of other alternatives, but this is the only one which works. And to my mind, it works beautifully. So I'm not looking any further. But you're quite welcome to try to come with a better proposal and say, no, I want to keep that diagram. I can't advise you because this diagram, which I had in the beginning of my talk, is extremely divergent. If you wait for a few seconds and then draw the diagram, then it becomes hopeless. So yeah, you have to, if you want to consider information, you have to do something else.
Okay, there are some questions. Ed, please ask question.
Hello, do you get a projective space after antipodal identification?
Well, the projective space is only on the horizon. So on the two sphere, which is formed by the horizon, you have the projective antipolar identification. The identification away from the horizon is that region two is identified as region one. That is to say, if I consider one point in the physical universe, that point sits both in region one and in region two. In region two, it's just a continuation of region one. And the rules are that analytic continuation at the origin of my diagram is that region one goes to region two. But but there's no other identification than that. So I think the answer to your question is only on the horizon. This reduces the surface area of the horizon basically by a factor of two.
There's a problem with projective spaces concerning orientability. For n-dimensional projective space, it is orientable if n is odd. In your case, it seems n is even for dimension. So it's not orientable.
I think that this theory is very specially designed for being in 3+1 space dimensions. I'm not sure, I don't know whether I want a consistent theory for black holes in another number of dimensions. Neither lower nor bigger, because that's not the physical world. I want my theory, first of all, to hold for the physical world. Then I'll be concerned about what might happen if you try to do this in other dimensions. You're welcome to try, but you're not guaranteed to get a good answer.
Okay. Thank you. There are more questions.
Yes, I had a question.
Please ask question, yes.
Gerard, to ask my question better, are you exchanging regions 3 and 4 or only regions 1 and 2?
Oh, regions 3 and 4 play no role. So you may or may not exchange them as you please. The only physical regions are 1 and 2, and then an infinitesimal extension beyond that, just to get the Hawking radiation straight. So it's region 1, region 2, and a small environment near the horizon that goes into region 2 and region 3 and region 4 infinitesimally, but that's just to do my calculations. And just like in ordinary physics, it's interesting to go infinitesimally towards complex space and time, but in finite space and time, it doesn't mean much. I consider region 3 and region 4 very similar to the analytic continuation of some physical function beyond its physical values of constants. So you go to complex coordinates, then in complex coordinates, well, anything might happen. You might have singularities, you have the black hole singularities there, but they are no direct consequence anymore in this theory.
Yes, in the explanation you mentioned a short while ago, you mentioned that the outgoing particle carries the information that the fast ingoing particle takes, and I was wondering how is that information exchange happens. And also a second one was, you mentioned that you cannot include incoming particles that have gone in too long ago, and how do you determine that time cutoff below which you don't include?
Well, that is in these equations. For every particle that goes in or out, you have the freedom either to describe it as an outgoing particle or to describe it as an ingoing particle. But this tells you that the ingoing and outgoing particles are related through these equations. So, so if your ingoing particle has too much momentum and it threatens to cause the gravitational shift, you say, no, it's easier to look at the outgoing particle whose coordinate is given by that same shift. But now the outgoing particle goes out, its coordinates becomes very big, but now I know exactly what happens to it. It's just leaving the black hole and that's it. So, in other words, I only need to consider particles which have a small amount of momentum under all circumstances. And that's the answer to your question, basically. So in this procedure, you avoid having particles that have a big gravitational effect on their environment. And indeed, the Penrose diagram for the eternal black hole assumes there's very little matter that disturbs the picture. There are some particles that cause some ripples around, but they don't disturb the entire space-time.
More questions, please?
Can I ask a question?
Yes. Yeah.
So I am just trying to understand you. You said this white region in your diagram is not part of space-time. What is the meaning of it? That means every particle enter, cross the horizon, appear at the antipodal point?
This is just, in mathematics, it's an ordinary thing to do that you tessellate space-time. So you take a region of space-time and you say, if I go to some other region or pass a border, I describe it in some other more suitable coordinates. So in the outside world, the suitable coordinates are just ordinary flat coordinates, but they're no longer suitable here. In fact, what you get is that you have to glue this point onto that point. That means the particles or whatever else never sit in the inside. As soon as a particle approaches the horizon here, it continues its way right there, which means there only is an outside region. There is no inside region at all for a black hole. And that is a way also to talk about regions 3 and region 4, like what Ed asked. Those regions do not exist if you want to do quantum mechanics. So I think it's important addition, if you want to do quantum mechanics, you might decide to look at everything classically, and then these regions 2 and region 3, they pop up again. Region 3 and region 4, they pop up again with the from the classical equations. But quantum mechanically, if you want to have pure states going to pure states, you should leave all that, I call it rubbish, you leave all that out. And so yes, then this inside region is completely empty. No space-time even.
So, but this inside region is what, this white region is what it says about the size of the black hole. Am I correct? How big the black hole is, and this white region.
No. Well, yes, you're right. But this gluing between the points on the black hole on the horizon causes space and time to be curved, because you could try this with a newspaper, just cut out a circle and glue the ends together. You'll find that newspaper gets rather severely rippled. It's not just a small change. So you can't do this for flat space. In other words, there's curvature all around, and that curvature describes the actual mass of the black hole.
Okay, so just one last question. When we think of how black hole formation, this white region starts with a small, it's small, it must be small at the beginning, then it grows, right? When then the collapse happens. So the size of the white region, right? How does it happen? How does it grow? For example, if the black hole is getting bigger and bigger, so Yeah.
Not sure I understood your question, but there is an important, very important question that is to ask, which is how can this get started? You see, because I start with exactly the diagram that I think you were asked about, the diagram where the black hole is formed by a collapse. And then you say, after a few seconds, I don't see the ingoing particles anymore. It means I want to make a different identification at the horizon, because the horizon now becomes too singular. The horizon, these ingoing particles now cause shifts on that horizon. I don't want that. I want to go to a more decent description. It is your choice to say, from now on, I'm going to use a better space-time that is easier for me to do to work with in connection with quantum mechanics. So as soon as you do that, you have made your decision that you no longer want to look at this very singular region in the past. I think from purely physical point of view, this is a very logical thing to do. If I ask you about radium, what are the Argus states of the hydrogen atom? You show a calculation. I can ask, yes, but is that an atom which is formed by the Big Bang, or is it an atom which was generated by some radioactive atom? You would say, well, its past doesn't matter. What happens is, what matters are the equations today, now. I say the same thing about black holes. The past, its past in the form of a very distant, very long past collapse process, or when it collapsed, or how it collapsed, or whether it collapsed at all, is immaterial when you ask questions about how the black hole behaves right now.
Okay, Steve Gittings, please ask your question. Yes, unmute yourself.
Thank you. Yes, hi, Gerard. Hi. Thanks for the nice talk. So a question, you've put a lot of focus on this interaction between the ingoing and outgoing particles, which if you think of them as real particles, there's potentially a big interaction there.
Yes.
But as we know in the conventional description, the notion of particle is somewhat observer dependent. And there is a description where the state near the horizon is very vacuum-like, if you describe it as seen by an infalling observer. And there's in that description, there's very little interaction between the ingoing particle and anything because the outgoing state is very vacuum-like. So is there a way of explaining in that way of discussing things what your effect is and how it works?
Well, there is a slightly different way of formulating this, which is to say that if you consider the outgoing particles, let's take Hawking's result that Hawking derives as that the outgoing particles form a Hartle-Hawking state. That is a single state. And I guess one way of asking your question is to ask, are there all these outgoing particles in a single state, or are they, and the ingoing particles maybe in many states? So how can I realize that the outgoing particles also are in many states? And the answer really is that you have to understand how quantum mechanics works. Quantum mechanics says, yes, you can put those particles in a particular state, maybe as entangled as you please, but that always means that if you use another basis in Hilbert space, then you have a complicated probability distribution of all the outgoing particles. But if you do that for the black hole, if all outgoing particles are found to be in a Hartle-Hawking state, then the local observer will say, that's an empty space-time, I see nothing. That's a derivation by Hawking to say that if the local observer sees nothing, the distant observer sees the Hartle-Hawking state, which contains particles. But now I can say, yes, but if you put detectors outside the black hole, they'll measure particles or no particles. Every now and then these detectors say click. And from that, you can reconstruct the state the particles were in. That's not going to be the Hartle-Hawking state. That's going to be another state. But now you can say, how can I understand that? And how can I write down a unitary operator which relates that to the ingoing particles? Well, I just showed you how this calculation does it. That if I assume first outgoing particles at some given coordinates, suppose an observer observed particles and has categorized the state as accurately as he can. Now I say, I'm going to give you the same black hole, but I throw in an extra particle. And then the observer says, now I see all different kinds of particles. What difference? Well, the difference is just a shift. So once you say it this way, it becomes obvious, well, how you would handle the situation in ordinary quantum systems. Nowadays, physicists are very familiar with ordinary quantum systems. So I can say, well, ask the same question for an ordinary hydrogen atom. Suppose you take a hydrogen atom which absorbs a photon and then it emits a photon a little bit later. What if I change the in state? The answer is, well, the out state will be a different state. And how different? Well, it's going to be a unitary transformation because the normal states are conserved and so on and so forth. And you show your calculation. I'm doing exactly the same, but now for a black hole. So a black hole produces, say, photons or gravitons or God knows what, but they're all detected by detectors around the black hole. And the detector finds it very difficult to detect a Hartle Hawking state. So that's not what it does. It detects things. And I say, whatever it detects, if I change the in state, the odds are it will detect different out states as well.
Let me just try again, and then we should possibly postpone for more extensive discussion. But so if I have an ingoing particle and a real outgoing particle, then that real outgoing particle can undergo a big shift, and you know that's an effect. But the state that say the Hartle-Hawking state or whatever state is formed by a collapsing black hole, again, looks very vacuum-like and in a sense doesn't have real outgoing particles down near the horizon. And so the question would be how to describe this effect in that language, which is part of the conventional description. Now, of course, we need a departure from the conventional description, but how would you describe your effect as some departure from that?
Well, we are doing quantum mechanics. So what we should be asking is throw in particles in the black hole, what particles come out? Mm-hmm. But the thing we know is if you throw in a Hartle-Hawking state, well, mathematically we can do that, physically we can't, but mathematically we can throw in a Hartle-Hawking state as in state, then the local observer will see no ingoing particles at all. Therefore, the local observer will see no outgoing particles either. So then the outgoing states will also be Hartle-Hawking.
Now, I would say maybe not exactly the Hartle-Hawking state, but something like, Rob asked the question earlier, collapsing black hole, so some state that describes collapse of a star to form a black hole, and then you produce something like the Hartle-Hawking state in the outgoing state. It has some extra excitations, but not, I think, in the modes we're talking about.
Yes, but then, in particular, if you take into account this gravitational shift, you will not get a unitary relation between all in states and all out states. So the question I originally asked is, how do I set up a scheme such that the black hole reacts just like a bucket of water or like an atom or a big molecule or whatever. I throw things at it. The object does some things and emits things as a response. Whatever that is called a scattering matrix, and that thing is unitary. That's the one thing we know sure about scattering matrix for physical reasons, as you know very well. So
I agree we would like to derive something that behaves that way, but anyway.
Right. But now, I permitted myself to turn the question upside down and say, okay, I know what happens to particles close to the black hole, but not at the black hole. So as long as they're a few millimeters away from the horizon, I know exactly how to calculate what happens. The only thing is inside the horizon itself. Now, how can I cure the theory such that the total out states is again has a unitary dependence on a complete set of all possible in states? And this is the answer. This answer works in practice. So I derived this scattering matrix and I think I'm happy with that matrix. Well, I'm not totally happy with it because I ignored all the other quantum numbers, but okay, that's a thing people also do. So why should I not allow myself to ignore other quantum numbers? But besides this, I get a completely unitary description. So I say this is a way in which nature could have taken care of the problem itself. And all I'm saying next is that it's a property of those horizons that if you don't take into account the fact that horizons cause shifts, then after a very short amount of time, the ingoing particles are messing up the outgoing particles completely, and you can't compute a thing anymore. So let's say that if I take an ingoing particle, I calculate the shift it causes to the outgoing particles, and that is a way to characterize a new state. Then I can, this way, I can throw away all the heavy ingoing particles, all ingoing particles that came in long ago. And of course, once you say that, you can say, okay, I include the particles which formed the collapse as well. So now I restore unitarity this way. In passing, I also throw away the firewalls in a way which I find very legitimate, whereas the other procedure I'm not so sure of. So it's a theory. In short, it's a theory that comes in a package. And there's all sorts of things in the package that you might not like, but it's the whole package that you have to buy if you want to believe the theory. And you're welcome to criticize it. Then you can say, then I ask, well, what's your package? But doing it this way, I claim works. It works fantastically well, not infinitely well, because I want to know how other particles behave, how particles depend on their quantum numbers and all that. I have to use gauge field, I have to use electromagnetism, start all over again. Yes, but this, I think, is as for a start, it gives you neutral particles with very dull properties. They give a very striking unitary relation between in and out.
Thank you. We should continue this. I know this is the nth iteration, and we'll continue it in the nth plus first of our discussion ongoing of this. But thanks.
Okay. Next question, Fabio.
Hello, Gerard. Very nice talk. Thanks. I have a question. In your model, is the equivalence principle preserved at the horizon? The fact that you have this vacuum hole construction. So a free-falling observer would be able to detect something when crossing the horizon or not?
Well, I am assuming that the in-falling observer doesn't change during an infinitesimal amount of space and time after he crossed the horizon. What happens next to that observer, I don't care, because I find all particles that I'll ever see from a black hole coming out in a unitary way, but those particles do not describe what happened to the observer after he went through the horizon. So I'm not using it. And in fact, as you should know, the region beyond the horizon, this region three in particular, is actually has space and time interchange. There's a singularity in it. And physically, it's of no use to work out from distance what you see coming out of the black hole. Therefore, that region in all respects is similar to what happens when you say I go to complex time values. I take any theory, take the planets going in ellipses, and you ask what happens with the planet if I say time is 1 plus i. And you might be surprised to find that its orbits show singularities, branch cuts actually, but of course physically you would say, well, I don't care what happens physically. I can't make my time complex. I'm confined to real time. So I give the same answer here. What happens to the horizon after he passed through, what happens to the observer after he passed through the horizon, I don't care about. It doesn't make any difference for the quantum description of the particles which I do see coming out of the black hole.
Okay, next question. I guess I saw one. James Booth, please.
Yeah, thank you very much. Thank you very much for the talk, and also to the organizers for organizing this fantastic conference and seminar series. I have a very simple question. So it seems to me that in this static example of the black hole, where the singularity is space-like, you have this very dualistic picture of a left universe, of a right universe, and it's very sort of like, it seems like very almost intuitive maybe to have this antipodal type of mapping. But if you have an astrophysical black hole, you have angular momentum, and you are no longer in a static, but now in a stationary situation where the singularity, for example, becomes time-like, you have this infinite tower of these Penrose diagrams, right? So the maximal extension becomes infinitely extended. So I was wondering how that would correspond to your antipodal mapping, if that is a fundamental sort of like obstacle, or how you think about this. Thank you.
No, this infinite tower of diagrams, that's what in Hawking Alice book, that tower also has regions one and region two, but then it has region three, four, five, six, seven, and so on. What happens in all those regions, I don't care, because they're not participating in the local physics. All I'm really interested in is what happens in regions one and region two, because they are directly connected through the origin to each other. And if I want to describe the regions in the origin correctly, I can't distance myself from the region two. Region two is a serious problem. But those other regions are all far away, like region three and region four. The other regions are similarly very far away. So I treat them just as I treat complex time in physics. I say it's interesting as a mathematical exercise, but whatever happens there happens, but it's not of our concern. It doesn't contribute in the physical data of particles leaving the black hole. So if that's my aim, I want to study, find out what happens to a particle that goes into the black hole. How does it leave its information in the outgoing particles? This is the answer. And what happens at complex time, I don't care about, nor do I care about what happens in all these other regions that the tower diagrams gives. The diagrams do not give other regions space like, well, that you can reach through wormholes so that you have even more spaces. Well, then you need the Feynman diagrams for two or more black holes. Then you have those other regions as well. And then you have to treat those other black holes separately.
I guess my question could be phrased in this way. Does it matter that the singularity is space-like? Or do you believe this a similar prescription to work as well for rotating black holes, where the singularity is time-like, or is it independent of the internal structure?
I think for rotating black holes, also the regions within the horizon, you have two horizons, you know, so you have to stay outside the far horizon. And there it still looks very much, logical speaking, the space-time structure looks very much like the Schwarzschild black hole. All these closed timeline curves and things like that, they're all hidden in these black holes. They're hidden by a cosmic sensor to be far within the, at least within the first horizon, I think, even the second one.
Thank you.
Okay. If there is no more questions, please, Gerald, could you please continue your talk?
Well, this was more or less my talk. So I was planning to continue just by answering questions, because I realized, for instance, the most important thing I didn't mention, which was that the, at least not in my talk, but I did mention it later, that this procedure of identification allows me to avoid overcounting. And at the horizon, what I do is I avoid overcounting by saying that particles with too high momentum are replaced by the things they do to the outgoing particles, which is shifting them. And then the outgoing particles carry the information of the ingoing particles by shifting. And once you say that, you have replaced the black hole, which has all these very high energetic particles, by a black hole which only has a very few of them. Let's see what I... Yeah, yes.
This is N, okay.
There's some literature. There is one concern which I find, that actually this diagram which I haven't shown yet. This is a diagram that tells you if you have a very energetic particle going not through the past event horizon, but getting in earlier. Such particles can be neglected if they are outgoing particles, because the Hawking particles, as you probably know, are very soft. They have a finite temperature, so very energetic particles really don't come out. So therefore, I don't need to consider very energetic particles going in. But I might want to do that anyway and ask the question, what happens if you throw in a very energetic particle away from the horizon? And the answer is very disturbing, because you can say, wait a minute, if the particle has very high momentum, I can apply a WKB approximation to it and treat it as a semi-classical object. And then you find that the theory that then tells you that the outgoing particle will have the Fourier transform of that momentum. But we are very close to the classical situation. So also the outgoing particle is a very energetic classical object. If you do the calculation, you find that the ingoing particle goes in through the horizon, then it behaves as if it hits against the wall. And then the wall is way before the singularity, and then the particle comes out again. But now you see that there's a danger of a closed time-like loop, because you're gonna have a particle might hit somebody else going in. The red particle may hit the line and affect someone to go in. For the ingoing particle, you have the same argument. So now you get a closed time-like curve. And the question is, there's a danger of closed time-like curves in this theory. I think the danger is not very high, because the odds of getting very high energetic orbital particles is very small. But if it's not zero, you might have a formal probability problem of the theory. And I haven't been able to sort this difficulty out. It seems to me that what you really have to say is, what's relevant for the theory are the diamonds which are of Planckian sizes. At the Planckian scale, of course, you expect a slight violation of causality, because the smooth coordinates are not the proper coordinates to use there. Many of us believe that Planck scale physics probably has to work with lattice series or something like that, where coordinates are discrete and there's no longer a continuum. If you try to make a continuum of coordinates, then of course you'll violate causality in a bad way. It just means you're doing a wrong theory. Probably it means something similar here, that I haven't found the best formulation yet of the theory, so that it looks as if it generates closed time-like curves. But it's a concern that I haven't been able to sort out. Of course, it would be lovely if these things really do happen, and you simply say that energetic particles going in may actually cause energetic objects to come out. That's normally not expected, but it would be great to see whether a LIGO or a Virgo or something, whether they can detect matter coming directly out of a black hole. That could be this effect, but I have big doubts there. I think rather this is an artifact of the theory that shouldn't be playing a big role, but it's something to be sorted out. I also briefly mentioned the relation between this theory, the string theory. The horizon of a black hole is very much like a string world sheet. And these insertions of particles going in at fixed points on the surface are very much like vertex insertions in string theory. In string theory, you also plug in extra momentum as a source of string behavior. And we do the same thing for the black hole horizon as well. We insert momentum and we use Green's functions in two dimensions. Well, we use them all the time in string theory. String theory is far advanced compared to what I'm doing here now. So in string theory, they found ways to interpret these situations in a physically acceptable way. I have not been able to do that here. So I don't know really what the Virasoro algebra, for instance, does to this theory. But sooner or later, you have to use conformal symmetries in this picture. And that's what string theory also does, particularly on the string world sheet. You're using conformal symmetry. So these different ways of looking at space and time and matter, they all come together. However, the theory is also in a very important way different from string theory. And that is that the black hole horizon is a Euclidean surface, whereas the string world sheet is fundamentally Minkowskian. You might say, oh, well, I just do a weak rotation and then it's all the problem has been solved. It's not that simple, because you can calculate what would be the corresponding string coupling constant or this string mass parameter, rho parameter of the string. You'll find that to be imaginary. So you find that this theory looks a little bit like strings with the imaginary string constant. That sounds strange. For string theorists, it sounds like something you should not do. But here it sounds like maybe the mathematics I'm doing has relationships with string mathematics. I would like to know how that works, but I really couldn't sort out many of the difficulties that you then get. Eventually, it could even be that some of the string mathematics goes through in the same way as in string theory. And that would be marvelous if true, but then you could apply the full machinery of string theory to the same picture. Eventually, of course, my real interest is to have all these things come together. I want one theory that tells you how to look at black holes. Black holes are far more than just a new useful exercise for doing physics. No, because the space and time themselves might be filled in with a space-time form. The virtual black holes might be everywhere in space and time, which causes a complete change in the way we look at space-time. So they have much more elementary consequences for space and time themselves as just being a curiosity caused by large amounts of matter in these theories. No, virtual black holes may arise with a very small amount of matter. In fact, I can imagine that many interactions in the real physical world are due to virtual instantons, virtual black holes, or black holes being exchanged, or something like that, so that black holes will be incorporated in a more complete way in a fundamental theory of nature. All this one can dream about and one can speculate about, but what it would be very important if this allows you to do real calculations. So I'd like to see how these black hole instantons, for instance, could really give rise to interactions that are worthwhile studying and that may eventually explain to us what how the Standard Model came about, for instance. That's one of the central questions that I'm looking at. So I really did not want to continue beyond this point. My time is also a little bit limited. So I want to break up at some point, but if there are some urgent questions, I'm still ready to answer.
Okay. So thank you very much for your talk, for your great talk, and some urgent questions, as I understand.
At least I remember Steve Giddings wanted to ask more.
Okay, are you sure?
That's okay. I think it would be a longer discussion, which, you know, Gerard and I have had a long discussion ongoing over time, but we should probably save that for another time.
I would love to see people carefully write down their questions or criticism or whatever about this or other comments. I like to formulate things by email, which I think I can do better than by just talking about them. But the bottom line will very often be that this is a package deal. You can't really understand the effects of this gravitational shift without interpreting region two in some way. If you don't do that, then it doesn't make much sense. So, and it's very difficult to treat black holes otherwise, I thought, than in time stationary or nearly stationary situations. So you could think of taking a black hole, throw in something every now and then ask what comes out of it. And those are meaningful questions which can be answered using this kind of theory. So I have a Hilbert space of in-states, a Hilbert space of out-states. The remarkable thing is that these Hilbert spaces do not contain the very heaviest particles because they already been taken care of by this Fourier transform to outgoing particles or other particles. So that is something to consider in when we are constructing more general theories of space and time. And one day then we hope to bring everything together. It's, of course, the real purpose of this investigation is not black holes, but to understand what's going on.
Okay. Please ask questions. Maybe I will ask very simple questions. If you can consider your construction, what about geodesic completeness of a space-time that you got?
Say it again, what kind of treatment?
What about geodesic completeness of your construction?
Well, that's the point about the Cauchy surfaces which I had.
Mm-hmm.
So let me try to find them back. Yes, so here you see that what a theory needs to have is a description of all states. And for me, that is take this Cauchy surface or take this one and put all the particles on that Cauchy surface. And then the question is, how does the Cauchy surface evolve in time? In particular, if for a distant observer, the Cauchy surface pivots around the origin, what happens in the extreme limit and how do ingoing particles affect outgoing particles? But I explained that the particles can jump from this side of the Cauchy surface to that side of the Cauchy surface, which forces me to take the entire line and not just stop right here. But you ask about geodesics. Well, these particles follow more or less ordinary geodesics in this region because this is just curved space-time background where a good physicist can always compute geodesics. And if you do quantum field theory, then we know how to solve the equations for fields in curved space-time. The problem comes if particles cross these horizons. And I said I only need to know what happens for a small infinitesimal region beyond the horizon, but not beyond that. I don't need to go as far as a singularity. And that is where geodesics in the classical theory cause problems. That's when they hit the singularity, you can ask what happens. Even more so in the Kerr or the Kerr-Newman solutions, where you have all these other regions beyond this, and you have even closed timeline curves beyond this, this region. So there they cause problems, but those problems are not my concern. My Cauchy surfaces end here, and they all stick to this diamond, and that will be altered except with gravitational shifts, which force me also to take this diamond into account to understand what's going on. But I don't need the forbidden regions, and that's where the dangerous and strange geodesics occur.
Okay, thank you very much. More questions, please? If not, let me thank Gerard for this fantastic talk. Thank you very much. If people have more questions, we can continue our SIAC channel, of course. So thank you very much for joining us at this seminar. And let me hope that we can meet in 2 weeks.
Steve Giddings has a question, I think.
Steve?
Oh, no, that was the reaction was the other symbol, the hand clap. So thank you, Gerard.
Okay. It seems that you have more than two hands. Okay.
I have this reference. This is a little children's story I tell for a researcher who happens to step across the horizon and all the strange things that happened to him. So you might be amused to read that, but you can also say it's... it's a children's story, but for children, it's a bit difficult to understand what I'm talking about, but besides. It's a cartoon version of the talk.
Oh, great, thank you.
Oh, comment, very interesting and very stimulating talk.
Thank you.
Very stimulating. Mm-hmm. After that, one wants to join to you.
Okay, thank you, Alek, for your comment, yes. Thank you. Okay, thank you very much. So I can close our first seminar. So thank you for thank you everybody. Bye.
Bye.